on Facebook once again. Hopefully this will get people to stop scrolling on their phone long enough. I got to stay in camera. It's the hard challenge. Staying in camera live. Hope that worked. I have to watch it later to see if I can even see myself. Hi. I don't know if I can see myself in my own live broadcast. It's kind of a fun. If you'd like to see that 20 or 30 more times, just go to my YouTube channel. And I've got tons of video on there of me doing exactly that. If you're just scrolling past and stopped because you saw fire, congratulations, you freaky pyromaniac. My name's Tom Britton. If you have questions, type them in. I got a couple, only a couple. Maybe this will be short. I'm doing live broadcasts because I need to promote shows. I've got one tomorrow night if you're in Chicago, and it is pay what you think it's worth as you leave, which means there is no ticket price. There are no tickets. If you go to freakshowandtell.com or freakshowtell.com, either way, got both domains, you'll find details. You just click, and you show up around 7 o'clock. To get a seat, show starts at 8. You can show up at 8 and hopefully get a chair. I've been doing two versions. So here's what I did. I've got my main show, which I'll be doing next weekend, June 1st, 2nd, and 3rd, in Waukegan, Illinois. So there you will see the regular show, and you pay a ticket price, and you come in and see the show. And I don't want to mess with that because you're paying a ticket price. I don't want to give you a show I'm not sure works with new material and new jokes. No, you're paying real money that you know spends, so I want to give you a show that I know works. So how do you rewrite a show if you're also selling the show? That's what I've been doing the last 3 weeks. That's what I'm doing tomorrow night. So I am doing the short version, and tomorrow night is your last chance, maybe last chance ever, to see this variation on Freak Show and Tell. So if you've seen Freak Show and Tell before, you've seen, well, more than you're going to see tomorrow night. Because the idea is to take that show and see what can burn off. How little can I do before I feel that it's too dumb or too short? I don't want to just get up there and eat fire. I have a theme to my show that I worked really damn hard to get. The idea that I'm explaining how fire eating works. That weird freak show science nerd thing, right? But maybe I don't need to go on for 15 minutes about how fire eating works. Maybe it's just as funny and maybe just as entertaining and maybe just as satisfying to me as the artist on stage. Maybe I could do it in 6. Maybe it needs to be 15. Maybe don't F with it, right? Well, the last 3 weeks I've been doing that. I've been taking out pieces, seeing if I'm happy, putting them back in, taking out another piece. Tomorrow night I've got some new ideas on how I'm going to do it. And then that lends itself to different jokes, more jokes, maybe better jokes. Don't know. So if you take out this whole history piece, you lose. I now can't make jokes about that because I didn't talk about it. If I take out this science thing, then maybe that joke about being a huge nerd doesn't work because I haven't really been a huge nerd. I've just kind of been a fire eater on stage. You see what I mean? As a writer, it's difficult. So tomorrow night, last chance to see the short version. Then I'm in Waukegan. Then I'm doing 3 of the long version. And this is where I'm going to test the other end. And that's also here in Chicago. All the details are on the website. There's no tickets to the long version either. When you show up, you're going to see a bed of nails in the lobby. That's for you to play with. Although I've got some stuff for bed of nails I might end up doing on stage. But the idea is now I'm kind of open miking my own show, and that's why you're not paying a ticket price. It's because I don't know. I can't guarantee the quality. I can't say, look, give me $50. It's worth every penny. Or give me $10. It's worth every penny. Or, hey, look, this is Hamilton the musical. Give me $350. It's worth every damn penny. Read the New York Times reviews. I can't do that. So the long version will be I'm adding a straitjacket. I'm going to add in a couple of just storytelling pieces. I've always liked storytelling pieces in the show, and I go back and forth on whether or not they fit my show. They kind of fit because I do stories wrapped around, like I eat fire, but I tell a whole story around eating fire. I do glass walking. I tell a whole story around eating fire. But what if I just told a story? Trying to make it fit into the show and not feel like it was just dropped in is what I'll be doing for 3 weeks in June. And so you can come again and again and again, watch that process if you want, or just come the one time. If you have questions, you type them in at any point. I will eventually read them all. I'm just not reading this live. So if anyone's chatting live, I'm not ignoring you. I'm one person. I'm Wizard of Oz back here trying to make sure things still working. So So that's what I'm doing. And so I'm doing Facebook Live to promote it. So if you can, I don't know if sharing this video is particularly helpful, but maybe you can share the event, which is just under Freak Show and Tell's page. You'll see events. I think everyone knows how to find events on Facebook. Maybe you don't. Share that, especially if you have friends who live in Chicago or Waukegan. Sorry to a few friends that I'm seeing now are tuning in who are from nowhere near here. I'm very sorry. And that's one of the questions I've got. So let me take them. The first one's from Amy, a friend of mine from high school who I've not seen in a million years. How do you decide where to perform? And then she says, how do I get my town on the list? So Amy, you live in the rural South, and that's a little tougher market. The economy's just different where I'm from. In Alabama, in Louisiana, in Georgia, in Florida, in Mississippi, the Deep South, sorry, for Northern Florida, really, the Deep South I'm talking about here, it's just a different economy. It's just hard for me to get down there. The theaters are just more sparse. So the way you get on the list is you have a theater call me. Have them call me. If I call them, I get a voicemail, and I just wasted my time, and I wasted their voicemail. They never, ever, 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 no exceptions, never call me back. Never. They don't even call me back to say, fuck you. Like, I get nothing. Nothing. Just no idea. If they call me, I answer the damn phone. And at least we can say, oh, we don't want to do this. It's a terrible idea. But something gets done. So I've just, as I've gotten older, I'm like, I'm not calling them. I've just been burned. As a fire eater, I've been burned too many times. I've learned my lesson. So if you have a theater or really an event space of any kind, I've done this in hotel ballrooms, any kind of room that has chairs in it, I would be willing to take their phone call, talk to them, look over the space, and when I turn them down, I'm very nice about it. I say, thank you so much for calling. I don't think it'll work. Maybe some friends of mine can use your space. If I call them, there, I just did it. I just called them. It's just as useful to just put your thumb in your ear. They never call me back. How do I decide where to perform? They call me, the places that will return my phone calls. It's usually places where what happens is I have a friend or someone who saw the show, and they're in, take the next place I'm going, Waukegan. My friend Zachary did a show there. And I called him because he was a friend of mine who knew the theater. See, if I called that theater, what would have happened? Nothing, nothing. I wouldn't be performing in Waukegan this weekend. They wouldn't have called me back. They never would have. Maybe they're an exception to the rule, but I haven't met one yet. Zachary, however, went by there, talked to them, got them on the phone with me. So that's usually what happens, is someone works at the theater or works in an event space. That's what happened in Detroit. The owner of a hotel came to a show, said, hey, this would work well at my hotel. Why don't you talk to my general manager? I said, have him call me, and he did. And then, deciding where to perform other than that. I've got two shows, so I've got Freak Show and Tell, and then coming this fall, we're bringing back, bringing back the Seance, which is Jonathan Pritchard and I. So if you're afraid of fire in your venue, there you go. That's just essentially like two stand-up comedians on the stage. It's a little different than that, but that's how much tech we need. We need a stage. Don't even really need a stage. We need chairs and a room. So this will play absolutely anywhere. I can tell you that the Seance is a historical and skeptical look at the Victorian-era Seance. It's players and performers. It was performed a lot. We did three shows a day during Halloween season when we launched it in 2015. The shows sold well or sold out. We did it at the Amazing Kaleburger when it was in business here in Chicago, did like a dinner theater thing. I think it was like 20 seats, but we sold out all 20 seats, two shows. We did the International Museum of Surgical Sciences. That show, there were empty seats, but not many. I mean, it was 80%, 90% sold out. And then Skeptic Camp, which doesn't count for ticket sales because if you came to Skeptic Camp, you then just came to our show. So Skeptic Camp was sold out. We benefited from that. What I'm getting at is that a lot of people have seen the seance. So I can tell you all day how great it is, but the reviews that came in, Yelp reviews, newspaper reviews, proper reviews, and like the Reader, people really liked it. And we enjoy doing it. So any of those places, call me. My number's on the website. And then we can move forward. The other question is from Kevin. How did you – I don't know Kevin. Sorry if I've met Kevin before. It wasn't on one of my friends list. How did you know you could make a living at, I'm reading off over here is why I'm staring into the distance. How did you know you could make a living as a fire eater? I just answered this question. My uncle was in town, and he asked a variation of that. The idea being, like, since I was a kid, I'd been into this kind of stuff. He said, you know, you really stuck with it. And that impressed him, that I didn't give up on this crazy dream of being a vaudevillian. That's what I wanted to be when I was a little kid. He knew me because I wanted to be, he was thinking I wanted to be Jim Henson. So I had all these puppets. I had ventriloquism figures. The dolls or dummies are called figures. I had ventriloquism figures. I had marionettes, Punch and Judy, and that involves a little whistle you put in your mouth, kind of thing. That was my obsession, was Jim Henson and the Muppets. And to stay in the vague realm of vaudeville was impressive to him. And I mentioned, so Kevin, same basic answer. When I was around 18 or 19, I got a brief glimmer on the horizon of success. And that little shining bit of gold in amongst all the muck convinced me I could do it, that it was possible for me to do it. Just 1 month, I made what was for me a lot of money, maybe $5,000 or $6,000, but I was 19 years old. My rent was $500 a month. So you're talking about a year's rent in a month. And I thought, man, if I could just do that, you know, 4 or 5 months out of the year, that would cover my living expenses. Then anything else I did would be extra money. That was how I thought back then. Can't say it's not how I don't think now. And that was my plan. That was my idea. If I could just get bigger and bigger and bigger, baby steps. So I never knew that I could make a living as a fire eater. I slowly discovered it piece by piece, bit by bit by bit. Was that it? That's the seance. That's the shows. All the information's on freakshowandtell.com. I said that. That's the two questions I got. I see people popping in and out, but not a lot of people watch this live. So a lot of you will be watching it in the future. If you look on my Facebook page, Freak Show and Tell, not my personal Facebook page, but Freak Show and Tell's Facebook page, you'll see me posting these live things on occasion. There's a message button. It's just the way you message a page. Click that and type in a question if it occurs to you at 3 or 4 in the morning, which is actually when Kevin was awake. It was like 2 a.m. I won't respond immediately. I'll save that question and then answer it like I just did for Amy and Kevin live on the broadcast, if you will. And then the last thing I want to tell you is that I'm doing a show. I'm doing a beta test called The Famous and the Freak on YouTube. So you got to go to my YouTube channel, and that'll be YouTube Live. Exact same thing as this, but I have to do it on YouTube because I have to use Hangouts because I've got a slideshow presentation that goes with it where I'm going to talk about, I've picked currently three, I may add more, three of my favorite, I was calling them freaks, but that's not really fair because one of them would not want to be called a freak. Two would have been okay with it, one wouldn't. So I'm the freak. The famous is them, and the freak is me, because I can always insult myself. But it's three of what we'd call sideshow or freak show performers, although one of them is the reason I say he wouldn't want to be called a freak. He's older than. He's from an earlier time when that wasn't a thing. But three very unusual people, and there's a theme between the three of them, and part of the surprise is the theme as it evolves. There'll be something a little more planned than what I do on Facebook. Eh, like a podcast. Broadcast live. That's the idea. So I'm again trying to bend genres, put things together. I haven't seen it done, though. I haven't seen someone go on YouTube and not just do a makeup demo, but to actually have prepared material, unedited, live. And I think that's because they aren't stage performers. They aren't used to just talking without a script, or in my case, with a rough outline of things I want to talk about. Live, without what else? Actually having it kind of together. So hopefully you'll watch it. That's in 6 days. That's May 31st. Again, I'm looking over here. At 8 p.m. on YouTube.com. And then it's YouTube.com/freakshowtell. But just Google, man. All this stuff's on my webpage. Everything's everywhere. As always, thanks to the core group of people that support every single thing I do. I hope one day you have a show that you struggle to sell tickets to every week, and I can repay the favor by giving you my time and attention, sharing things to your page, just repurposing crap, just reposting crap, retweeting on Twitter, hitting like on Instagram, sharing the crap that I've just boosting the signal, as it's called. I don't know if it makes a difference. Honestly, don't know. I may be wasting my entire time right now. I may just be wasting my time and yours. No one's going to see this, and not a single ticket will be, let's say, sold, but no one's going to show up tomorrow because they saw this video. I don't know. But I appreciate your time and attention in investing in something. So even if it isn't selling tickets, even if it isn't moving anything forward, it means the world to me. And if I'm your friend, then that means something to you. Like, I do notice that you're helping me out. I'm just sometimes a little too anxious, a little too crazy to say thank you. So thank you so much for all of that. And thanks for tuning in. Thanks for watching this nonsense. Join me on YouTube on the 31st, and I might do more of these in the future just because already on the computer. Might as well use it for something. It doesn't cost anything.